You're listening to B2B Tech Talk with Ingram Micro, the place to learn about new technology and technological advances before they become mainstream. This episode is sponsored by Ingram Micro Security. Strengthen your security practice. Let's get into it.
Welcome to B2B Tech Talk with Ingram Micro. I'm your host, Kerry Roberts, and my guests today are Casey Borison, a channel sales engineer at Proofpoint, and Jake White, a technology consultant at Ingram Micro. Welcome, Casey and Jake. Thank you for being here.
Hi, Kerry. Thanks for having us. Appreciate it.
Hey, Kerry. Thanks for having me on again.
So what I found interesting as I was learning about each of you a little bit more, Casey, you started your career in the construction industry, and Jake, you studied psychology and social work. And I would love to know how you made your way into this tech and security world and what excites you about this industry. And Casey, I'll start with you.
Yeah, sure. I think everyone has interesting stories of how they kind of ended up in the tech industry. I started off out of college as a commercial project estimator manager for a large contractor in Chicago. I did that for about 4 years until the commercial market crashed in 2009, right after the residential market. And I was unfortunately let go. Took a bunch of computer science classes in college, and IT was always something I eventually wanted to get into. So I knew a bunch of people at CDW and in the IT field when I was looking for work. So I decided to pursue that direction. I started off at CDW in sales and knew very quickly that I wanted to move into security and eventually be a sales engineer. So I moved out of sales, went on to their security team at CDW, did that for about 6 years before making the jump over to Proofpoint as a sales engineer. I've been here for about 2.5 years. I love it. Security is, you know, a very interesting field, and it's ever-changing. It keeps you on your toes. It's always something new to learn, and it's going to be around for a very long time, and it's a functionality of everyday life in the world that we live in today.
No, I think that's great. And Jake, you were telling us that you kind of fell into security by accident. I'd love to hear more about this as well.
Yeah, Kerry. So that was that's the funny thing about it is that I had no intentions of being in the IT field when I started out. You know, I, like you mentioned, I went to the University of Buffalo for psychology in my undergrad. Then I did my master's in social work. And while I was working on that, I worked at our university's help desk, first as a call center agent and then as a supervisor for 3 years. So really all I was doing there was something that I knew a little bit about to help pay the bills while I was working on my master's degree. And, you know, as I mentioned, the long-term game plan was to work in mental health. Much like what happened with Casey, the financial crisis in 2009 had an effect on me. I graduated in the middle of it and couldn't find work anywhere. It was dry as a bone trying to find something to keep the lights on in my place. So I leaned back on what I knew, which was IT. I went to a temp agency and I started looking around for just what was available. And lo and behold, they had a starting position at Ingram Micro in their call center. I said, well, I know call centers, I know IT. This seems like it's going to be a good fit. And then 10 years later of climbing the corporate ladder, here I am in the consultant level. You know, I really like security, like Casey said, because it's always changing. There's always something new. Just when you think things are getting boring, attackers come up with new and exciting and quite frankly horrifying ways to make sure that I'm always employable. And every day kind of brings this new and unique challenge of looking at, you know, what's going on out in the world today. You know, you can see things in the geopolitical space have an effect on what we do on the security side. And I think that's really cool.
No, I think that's great. We had Chris Wilkes on from IBM the other day saying there's about 3 million jobs that are not being filled yet for security. So as you said, it's ever growing. There's definitely people that need to be here. And it has been said that the biggest threat to security can many times be the people that work at an organization. And Casey, Proofpoint says they are people-centric when it comes to cybersecurity. What does that mean?
Yeah, Proofpoint has a people-centric strategy. And when we look at, you know, the modern threat landscape, it's fundamentally shifted to focusing on people. We're seeing a huge amount of targeted campaigns in lieu of the high volume attacks of the past, with organizations adopting the cloud with platforms such as Office 365 or G Suite. We must provide them with as much visibility into the risk to their users. Understanding not just who is being targeted, but how is very important. Attackers are constantly changing their tactics with new tricks, and there's really no single threat actor that is really completely dominating the stage. And because of this, we need to kind of focus the attention on the target, your users. And last time I checked, we're all human. And because we are all human, we are also flawed and make mistakes, which means we can be tricked. The attackers, who are also human, know this and exploit our flaws very effectively. And Proofpoint's security approach centers around people. We deliver the most effective solution to protect people from the threats that target them, the data they create, access, and share, and enable timely response to security incidents when they do happen.
And I really like this approach, you know, coming from kind of the neutral third party side here and in distribution. But what I'll tell you, coming from mental health and coming from, you know, where my core studies were in college, I really like this, right? Normally, I'm the one that's standing on the soapbox, flapping my arms around and saying, guys, we need to pay attention to people. We need to make sure that we're looking at our users. And, you know, Proofpoint's ahead of the curve, which is one of the reasons why I really like working with them, is they kind of understand it and look at things kind of in a similar way to what I do.
Oh, see, that college degree is paying off, Jake. That's good. As we just said, in the modern threat landscape, it's not infrastructure that's being targeted, but rather attackers are targeting individuals. Why is that, and how has this changed in the way that we look at security?
Yeah, Carrie, it's much easier, faster, and cheaper for me to do my own research, create and weaponize some maliciously targeted email to someone or even you, rather than me trying to navigate through traditional security perimeters and various other security controls within an actual IT environment, just to deliver a payload or grab sensitive information, maybe even steal or gain your credentials for something else that I want, or possibly impersonate someone within that organization like Ingram Micro. And this is all done by our own doing. Everything is human activated. Human activation is what attackers are relying on nowadays. If I can get you, Carrie, or you, Jake, to click on a link, which takes you to a malicious website, or get you to click on an attachment, like a Word doc, a PDF, for you to download a malicious file for me, then it's game over. And giving organizations, you know, unparalleled visibility into the threats and understanding the user actions and behaviors is key. And by utilizing the tools in Proofpoint's portfolio with our multi-layered threat detection, we can help keep the user safe and stop threats that target them.
Yeah, and building off what Casey said, you know, people tend to be really the weakest link in the chain when it comes to information security, right? You can guarantee that a machine can stick to a policy. If I tell a server or a firewall what to do, you know, barring any major issues with that system, they're going to stick to that policy. But people are unpredictable, and you know, they're also motivated by incentive. They can have their thinking short-circuited by things like fear or panic, right? And those are the things that attackers are counting on, is that human behavior, right? Humans are unpredictable in the way they behave, but there is some level of predictability because we all kind of have these different things in common, such as the fact that, you know, when we panic, sometimes our decision-making isn't really solid. So that's what the attacker's counting on there, is the fact that we're going to make a mistake and eventually let them in.
Now, as you're both talking about, attacks are constantly on the rise in some form or fashion, and yet organizations are historically investing their IT spend into network, endpoint, and web security solutions. Why is this a challenge, and where does email security fit into this whole conversation?
Yeah, I definitely say this is a challenge, Gary. Attackers are trying to go around the walls that we're building in network and endpoint security, right? It's kind of what you'd view as the traditional stuff. They don't want to have to fight with those systems. They're pretty well developed, right? If we look back at what firewalls looked like in the 90s. You know, it was you know, not very well developed. Same kind of with endpoint security. We've come a long way in the past 30 years when it comes to those controls, and they're really strong now. So instead of having to fight with those really strong controls, and honestly, most people already have them, they're going to go around and get that easy payday. And that's where kind of that people-centric piece that comes in that Casey's been talking about. So if we look at the stats here in the 2019 Verizon DBIR report, which looks at breaches and breaches that Verizon's incident response team responded to, 94% of those breaches started with attacks that target people through email. I mean, that's a staggering number, 94%. If we look at the other side of the coin, on a recent Gartner study, it showed that the IT communities are probably only spending about 10% of their security budget on email controls. Well over half that budget goes into, you know, what you'd expect, which is firewalls, right? That's a huge mismatch in where we're defending versus where we're being attacked. So we really need to adjust to these new threats that we're facing and make sure that we're not putting all of our eggs in one basket, right? We got to focus on where the attacks are coming in and put up these new walls, which is around email and our people.
Yeah, and I think that Jake really summed it perfectly. As humans, we learn, we evolve, but so are the attackers. They're not just going through the traditional security measures as Jake was talking about. They figured out that the most effective way to attack an organization is to attack an individual through email. Organizations need to shift their security strategy to where their greatest risk is. You are probably beginning to kind of notice a common theme here, but your greatest asset is also your greatest risk. It's your user. And the most common tool used to exploit this risk is email. We need an effective email threat protection solution, including advanced threats that come in the form of attachments and URLs to minimize these risks to your users. And you can't do this without data. You can't do this without intel. And we have a ton of it. We see the most threat data in the world, and our threat research and intel team analyzes and correlates all this data back into all of our products. So if you really want to invest your time, effort, and money to stop these threats, you really should follow the threat vectors down to the user, which ultimately starts with email at the core.
So how can organizations effectively identify risk and respond to these user interactions?
Yeah, I think, Carrie, like a lot of different, or like a lot of security, it's a delicate balance between, you know, policy and security controls. So you need to craft a policy in your organization that reaches beyond the IT department into places that are adjacent and also, you know, kind of people-centric, right? So think about HR and places like executive leadership that will help drive user behavior, right? There's got to be some level of enforcement. I think everybody needs to work together on this. In turn, you also need a set of security controls in place that are going to ensure that those policies are being followed and also protect against the behavior that we can't control or shape, right? There's always going to be some bad eggs in there who aren't going to follow the rules or pay attention. You know, there's always something like that that's going to work against us. So we need to make sure that we've got kind of the other side of the coin taken care of in our security controls. And we also need to look at some of the behavior that we can't control or shape on top of that, which is the behavior of attackers or threat actors, right? We can't tell the bad guys to follow our security policies. So the security controls need to be in place to keep them behaving as well. So, you know, it's really all about balance, right? It's got to be policy and controls working together.
Yeah. And Jake, you also hit on a very important point with user behavior, right? So in order to really identify and respond to risk, you need to understand what that user behavior is. Email is number one threat vector that we've been talking about, with the other being a close second, which is cloud. And at Proofpoint, we are giving organizations unmatched visibility into their risky users. And we're doing this by showing who their very attacked people, or VAP for short, are. These are people who are consistently being attacked. They're consistently being targeted given their ability to access sensitive data, their likelihood to click on things, and they are usually always someone who fails some sort of security awareness training, which leads me to user behavior. if you can understand the behavior, especially of a very attacked person, we can give them necessary and adequate training through phishing simulations and other various adaptive training to correct and change their bad behavior. And through security awareness training and our threat response autopull product, we can help learn to identify potentially suspicious emails and notify and alert the security team, while at the same time, threat response autopull will analyze the suspicious message that that person notified the security team on and have an automated process of quarantining the malicious emails in the user's inboxes post-delivery, which is key.
Real quick, before we jump straight back into the episode today, we want to tell you about Ingram Micro Financial Solutions and how you can maximize your buying power and get to yes with your customers faster. For the last 9 years, Ingram Micro has been Channel Pro's reader's choice for best financing options. Put the power of our credit and leasing options to work for you. You can easily contact financial solutions at ingrammicro.com. All right, let's get back to the show.
Now, a lot of what we talk about on this show is that security starts with leadership. It starts at the top of an organization. And obviously, there's people in an organization that that's their focus, the IT part, the security part. But where does it come in where, you know, your marketing team, your managers, your front office, whose responsibility is it for them to be teaching these people the importance of this versus them just getting an email or a worksheet? Can you talk a little bit about how you would have this conversation with people that maybe aren't involved directly with the tech at an organization?
Yeah, I think there's various products out there where you have to have different levels of conversation. Sometimes it's a business conversation. Sometimes it's a security conversation. You have to know and understand who you're talking to, and you have to know and understand what their needs are within the organization from a security perspective. And by understanding what their needs are, you can focus your attention to what we have in our portfolio that can fill those gaps and holes and hopefully help them gain the visibility, gain the security that they need in order to turn their users into part of the security solution.
Yeah, and one other thing that I would pitch in on there is you've always got to tie it back to business outcomes, right? If you want to get the buy-in from people who are non-IT oriented in your organization, it's got to be business outcomes. So you want to look at things like, what does this lead to in terms of our profitability as a company? How can we reduce our legal or compliance risk by going out there and look at these controls or changing our policy, right? It's got to be something, from kind of a human incentive perspective for that person in the organization. So if I'm a security admin or if I'm a CISO and I'm sitting there thinking, well, how can I get my CEO or CFO on board with taking a look at a new security policy or a new security control, it's got to be what's in it for them, right? What's important for them? What are they driving towards? What are their goals for this year? And how can I make security fit into that?
That makes a lot of sense. Casey, you've talked a lot about Proofpoint as an email security provider and how they can keep users safe when it comes to their inbox. Can you tell us a bit more about these people-centric security tools that might fall outside of the scope of just email?
Yeah, that's a great question, Carrie. And, in order to protect people, we're going to detect and assess not just the attack, but who's being attacked, their vulnerability and risk, their privileges and access to sensitive data. And from there, we can kind of apply adaptive controls to protect the sensitive information with things like email DLP and cloud DLP with our CASB solution. We can protect access with zero trust, and we can even isolate clicks and links of unknown URLs. And as I stated in the previous question, we have threat response autopull, which allows us to orchestrate and automate a timely response to when malicious emails actually enter our environment post delivery. Because we are not 100%, we don't always catch everything. We're not going to say that we do, but we got to have the ability to identify when those scenarios do happen and be able to respond to them. We also just discussed security awareness training, which is highly customizable training for your user base We're also looking at preventing BEC, which is business email compromise, or when attackers actually pretend to be you, Kerry, or you, Jake. And then we also look at EAC, which is another common term that's you know reared its ugly head, which is email account compromise, when the attacker actually becomes you and your account has been compromised. And lastly, we're going to complete the ecosystem by integrating with, you know, various other security partners like Palo Alto, Splunk, Okta, and CrowdStrike, just to name a few.
You know, I have a question about email as a whole, Casey, because, you know, there are big organizations that have their own email set up. There are people that use Outlook. There are people that use Gmail and Google Suite. They use a hybrid cloud solution. Is there a difference in the type of email? Is one more secure than the other? Are attackers choosing one more than the other? Does Proofpoint kind of work with all of this?
Yeah, Proofpoint works with all of it. You know, we're not seeing one specific solution being targeted more than the other. We could possibly say that, you know, Microsoft is being targeted more than G Suite, but that's just simply because there are more organizations that are using the Microsoft, you know, suite in Office 365 or on-prem Exchange. So we don't have a clear basis to say, you know, that's being targeted more than this, but we do collect a lot of data. We see the most emails out of anyone. We see, you know, we're collecting this data, not only through email, but cloud applications, users, and ISPs and service providers, so that we can have the database for the threat intel that we can correlate that back into our products. We can identify, you know, what's being targeted, where is being targeted, who's being targeted. And that's what's key. And then, you know, like I said, you need a multi-layered approach. And that's true to anything, whether it's, you know, your traditional perimeter security or all the way down to the endpoint, you know, you still have a multi-layered approach there. And you have to do the same thing on the email side, pre-delivery, before it gets onto the network. And having that multi-layered approach and being able to, you know, have as much visibility into what is coming in or leaving your organization is what is going to be highly key for, you know, organizations to stay safe.
You know, to build on that, if I'm an attacker, I'm just going to go where the money is, right? I'm going to use whatever your organization is using. And, you know, kind of to the point earlier about kind of, you know, this people-centric approach, attackers aren't really focusing on platform anymore. They're focusing on vertical market a lot of the same way that you would see in the reseller community, where resellers focus on specific types of verticals. Attackers are doing the same thing. They say, I'm going to get really good at being a healthcare attacker and going after hospitals, or I'm going to be a really good small, medium business attacker and go after people who probably don't have enough spend to worry about their own security, right? It's weird that we've seen this alignment in the attacker side of things, where it's not about platform, it's not about like techie, really advanced conceptual attacks anymore. It's we're going after people and we're going after specific verticals that we can specialize in.
That's interesting. Is there a vertical that is being attacked more than others, or they're just all equally dispersed at this point?
They're all equally dispersed at this point. It's whoever's got the cash and whoever's going to pay up. You know, I think the funny thing, if we kind of look back over the past year and with some of the things that have been going on, is that attackers said, we're going to take a break this year and we're not going to attack hospitals as much as we said we would. And then some recent research has shown, criminals are lying. And of course, they went after hospitals this year. So yeah, I mean, there's nothing stopping them. And there's really no one segment that is attacked really more than others. It's just, hey, if you got cash, they have the time.
Yeah, Kerry, healthcare is always going to be high. Financial institutions are always going to be high. And, you know, like Jake was saying, you have to look at where the sensitive data is, right? And what attackers are, you know, going to gain most from for their own personal, you know, investment in what they're attacking. So you just have to understand the threat scenario that's out there. And even things of just preying on the fear, right? So, you know, the whole COVID thing, the pandemic, you know, there's been, we've seen such a huge increase in phishing attempts that are being used with COVID, or Black Lives Matter. You know, they're building off of what is going on in the world and they're profiting off of it. So you can see trends, but historically, you usually look at, you know, the healthcare, government, financial institutions are always going to be at the top.
Another question that pertains to this as we're talking about attackers. I'm curious, has there been any data to show that there is a large group or a certain amount of attackers that come from a place of work? You know, they worked at an organization, they were fired, they left, maybe they had access to something, and they would be more likely to be an attacker. Is that of concern or not really?
No, it absolutely is. Insider threat is a huge problem. And threats that come from inside the organization of scenarios of what you just said, or even mistakes, simply setting something out that you didn't know that you shouldn't, is huge. And that's where we're going to start to see an uptick in, you know, unified DLP strategies come into play. And looking at, you know, a product like what we have with Observe It, who kind of, you know, pans out into identifying these threats that are coming from inside the organization and alerting on them, and kind of correlating that with, you know, the endpoint user behavior and certain other, you know, access of certain systems as well. So that's definitely coming into play. And I think that is coming to be a major focus within the next year or so, especially with, you know, what we're going to talk about later on, but, you know, just the whole organizations going to a remote workforce permanently. So that's going to be something that we need to focus on 100%.
Which brings me to our last question, which is one we ask all the time, which is, where do you see technology going with in the next year? And Casey, I'll start with you.
Yeah. What's next, right? I just alluded to it a little bit. You know, well, we've kind of already started that journey to the cloud, right? That train's already left the station, but it's going to be more complicated once you start adding in the human factor, right? And given the shakeup of the recent world events, like we had just been talking about, and organizations kind of scrambling to get to that distributed workforce, I really feel that we're going to, you know, start to see more organizations even move to a permanent distributed workforce. And because of that, you know, we'll see more reliance on the cloud, and we're going to have to protect those users and those remote users who were traditionally on-prem. Also, we're going to be looking at, you know, SASE, which is Secure Access Service Edge. That's going to be gaining strength in the next year. And this incorporates a few important functions like the cloud application security, CASB, and the need for zero trust to make sure that the correct users only have access and privilege to what they need. And I can also see that, you know, we're going to see a major uptick in training users how to work remotely, which is going to come into play with security awareness training. And, you know, making your users a part of the organization's security strategy is going to be the ultimate goal here.
Yeah, to kind of build off of that as well, I think we're going to see a lot of businesses wonder why they're going back to the office when they've been operational since the end of Q1 with a remote workforce. I know that some people are going to stay traditional and kind of go back to the four walls, but we're in the middle of a potential revolution in remote workers. And, you know, I've already had multiple conversations with organizations that are coming back and saying, okay, if we do this, what are the security implications? What are, you know, what can we do to make this work better for us if this is something that is going to remain permanent? I think this is we're looking at potential big revolution in the way that people do their jobs every day, especially people who are information workers like Casey and I. You know, I used to be 100% in the field guy, and I have been home since February-ish. So, you know, I'm curious, and I think about this every day, hey, is this going to be, you know, my life going forward is working out of my office instead of being on an airplane all the time? But yeah, I mean, if that change does happen, as I mentioned, I think there's going to be a lot of interesting implications for security and implications for the way that we do IT compared to the old-fashioned way. There's, you know, your IT guy isn't going to be the person who's crawling under desks and wiping the dust off of the old power strip and stuff like that. you know, a lot more of your work might be done with UPS and packaging up those systems and shipping them out. And then how do we deal with those systems and how do we deal with all of that, those IT assets once they have left the nest and are now out in the wild, right? It's a completely different way of doing your job compared to the way you're used to.
You know, Jake, I'd like to go off of that because I wonder that as well. You know, so many people have been working from home. It's been working that the question becomes like, well, why do I need to go into the office? And some companies are really pushing for that. Is it primarily because of the concern of security, or is it because, well, I'm paying this rent for this space? You know, what is it? Why are some companies really pushing to go back to a building when it may not be necessary?
Yeah, I think it's a little everything, right? I don't think that I can pin down one exact reason why companies are making the decision to go back to working in an office. I definitely think that the sunk cost of having a building is a part of that, right? If you're paying a mortgage or paying rent on a facility, you do want to get some ROI out of that, right? You just don't want it to be dead money sitting inside a facility. That's certainly a piece of it. But everybody else has got their reasons, right? I mentioned having some conversations with different customers, one in particular whose name I will anonymize, obviously, but one in particular said, hey, I just spent the past year and a half getting my getting my security set up the way I liked it, getting my network segmentation set up the way I like it. I had everything in order, and then COVID happened, and then now I have to completely tear apart my network map and the way I have my security set up, and I have to start from scratch, right? So we're talking about well over a year's worth of labor to get their IT in order and then having to scrap that and start over. That could certainly be a piece of it as well, right? There are a lot of different drivers that are getting people back into the offices as we see some of the effects of COVID dwindling down in different parts of the country. So, you know, those motivators are going to be different for everybody. And you know, kind of as I mentioned, we've been talking about a lot about people-centric and talking about kind of the human factor here. I think that's the thing you got to get with your decision makers and ask, right, is what are the motivations? What are the reasons? You know, what are the potential risks and pitfalls? And let's make sure we're doing this right.
We talked about a lot of different things today, especially within the email security space. Where can people learn more about everything we spoke about or connect with you if they want to ask questions? And Casey, I'll start with you.
Yeah, thanks, Carrie. We absolutely have a lot of good places for resources on information. If you're a Proofpoint partner or interested in becoming a Proofpoint partner, you can go to our partner hub at partner.proofpoint.com. If you're a customer, you can go to proofpoint.com where you can read and download anything that we've discussed today. We have a lot of other resources that you can you can dig a little deeper into what we discussed, such as our user report, our human factor report, and Protected with Proofpoint. You can go on there and we'll send those links out in the description.
And you can catch up with me at jacob.white@ingrammicro.com. And if you want to learn more about Ingram Micro's security product offerings and services, you can always head over to securitylinecard.com.
Great. Thank you both, Jake and Casey, for being here and for your insight. We greatly appreciate it.
Thanks, Gary. No, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Great being back.
If you like this episode or have a question, join the discussion on Twitter at Ingram Tech Soul with the hashtag B2B Tech Talk. Thank you for tuning in and subscribing to B2B Tech Talk with Ingram Micro.
You've been listening to B2B Tech Talk with Ingram Micro, hosted by Carrie Roberts. This episode was sponsored by Ingram Micro Security. B2B Tech Talk is a joint production by Sweetfish Media and Ingram Micro. Ingram Micro production handled by Laura Burton and Christine Fan. To not miss an episode, subscribe today in your favorite podcast platform.